death smells. I mean, death has a special smell over and above the smell of cyanide, cordite, blood carrying her burnt flesh. It's a gray smell. It stops the heart, cuts off the breath. Smell of the empty body, smell of field hospitals and gangrene.
Now, folks, if you'll just care to step this way, you are about to witness
the complete all-American de-anxietized man.
William Seward Burroughs, heir to the Burroughs Adding Machine Company, founded by his grandfather, was born in 1914 in St. Louis, Missouri. After graduating from Harvard University and traveling Europe, he moved to New York City, where he met his future wife, Joan Vollmer, and fell in company with Jack Kerouac and Allen Ginsberg. Experimenting with new forms of literature, as well as drugs, the three friends formed the vanguard of a cultural phenomenon that would come to be known as the Beat Generation.
Thanksgiving Day, November 28th, 1986. Thanks for the wild turkey and passenger pigeons destined to be shit out through wholesome American guts. Thanks for a continent to despoil and poison. Thanks for Indians to provide a modicum of challenge and danger. Thanks for vast herds of bison to kill and skin, leaving the carcasses to rot. Thanks for bounties on wolves and coyotes. Thanks for the American dream to vulgarize and falsify until the bare lies shine through.
In the 50s, anything opened up a good avenue to thinking, because it was, people talk about the 50s, they see Happy Days and think it was fun. It was horrible, the 50s. It was the most terrible time. It was the first memory I had, and it was of you had to be exactly like everybody else.
The Beat Generation was crushing that. It was an attempt to bust out of that, man. All of this was a big rap on the knuckles of mainstream, white, staid, pool in the backyard America.
Kid, what are you doing over there with the niggers and the apes? Why don't you straighten out and act like a white man? After all, they're only human cattle. You know that yourself. I hate to see a bright young man fuck up and get off on the wrong track.
So, what was the Beat Movement? It was real.
The Beat Movement, well, of course it was. It underwent many changes in the 60s. It became quite political.
Yeah.
But as I've always said, it's more a sociological than a literary phenomenon. It was a sociological movement of worldwide importance. Unprecedented worldwide importance. A cultural revolution, you might say.
So I would characterize it as a spiritual liberation movement, actually. Black Women's Lib, Black Lib, Spirit Lib, that began in the 40s, first took shape as a literary movement with a production of a number of notable utterances.
Allen Ginsberg's first publication was Howl. It was published in 1956. In 1957, Jack Kerouac's On the Road, and in 1959, Naked Lunch by William Burroughs. These three books came out.
Beatniks were big. Overnight, it was a huge, like a hula hoop, much to their embarrassment, I think, and because it started out pretty much in North Beach and stuff, like poets. And so once it became so big in the media, it was, they were embarrassed by that term.
All of those poets, they couldn't fit what the stereotype of Beat was. That was a media hype to sell papers. And they pimped that boy, they pimped that bad boy, really.
Burroughs himself never identified with the Beat Generation. He was a godfather and mentor. He was a bit older, and since he was also Harvard educated, he just brought in a whole bunch of ideas just from classical education that he had.
And invented a style of book, almost. I mean, it was so original. And anything that's so original like that eventually lasts.
Cut. Tangle. Word line.
This man, the stimulus ripples were caught back, even in the day description, in area of vision, as a flickering experience will project further experience in the company uses of mass subliminal deramers who...
I think probably Freud would think him to be deeply, deeply troubled, profoundly mentally ill.
Everybody was enamored by William because he was famous before anybody else, and he was also famous for all the wrong things. He was the first person that was famous for things you were supposed to hide. He was gay, he was a junkie, he didn't look handsome, he shot his wife, he wrote poetry about assholes and heroin. He was not easy to like.
Class was an essential factor in the work and life. William came from a very traditional upper crust American family. Though the fortune may have been lost, the breeding was deep and instilled, and thus the gentleman we know was bred.
I could totally relate to the dry thing, that salesman thing that he'd created, you know, and this very underplayed thing, just very, very removed, very removed. Also very, very interested in death. And I think that's what scared Americans more than his writing itself. If he'd had that worldview and he was writing in a more polite way and it didn't have to do with guns and junk.
Usually the most radical work tends to come from the upper classes, because they're trying so hard to shock, so hard to get away from their roots. So he's a fascinating character, uniquely American in that regard. I don't think that work could have existed had he not been breaking away from an incredibly patrician Midwestern background.
There was no rebellion in those days. No, certainly not in that Stratton. Or very little that I saw. There might have been isolated cases, but by and large, they were in a good spot, their families were in a good spot, and the sons wanted to just go along exactly the same way. Thanks for the KKK for nigger killing lawmen feeding their notches. For decent church-going women with their mean, pinched, bitter, evil faces. Thanks for Kill a Queer for Christ stickers. Thanks for Laboratory AIDS. Thanks for Prohibition and the war against drugs. Thanks for a country where nobody is allowed to mind his own business. Thanks for a nation of finks. Yes, thanks for all the memories. All right, let's see your arms. You always were a headache, and you always were a bore. Thanks for the last and greatest betrayal of the last and greatest of human dreams.
But Burroughs achieved a great deal more than being arguably the greatest writer in the world in the second half of the 20th century, because he did break down so many barriers, and he did play into and influence so many other fields, like rock and roll, like the movies.
Well, William seemed to have a connection with anything and everything. You know, you see
a movie like Blade Runner, and then you find the phrase Blade Runner came from him. The term heavy metal is attributed to him. Soft machine, you know, there's so many phrases, names of groups that come from William's work. He's like another kind of Bible.
He's a great pioneer of the gay liberation movement, or the whole position standing of gay people around the world, really, now.
Where did you learn about sex originally? From friends?
Books.
Books, yes. Books.
There's a book called The Plastic Age by Percy Marks, was sort of a daring book in the 20s. And The Green Hat and Coming of Age in Samoa. This is the 20s I'm talking about, which is a very different era.
Burroughs once said to me, if one man stands up and, you know, rejects the bullshit of society, it makes it possible for everyone else to follow on. And he was that man to some extent.
And here is Reverend Braswell in the Denver Post. Homosexuality is an abomination to God and should never be recognized as a legal human right any more than robbery or murder. At the present time in Colorado, where this was written, approximate mob conditions prevail. And by mob, I mean my own business. No sex crimes on the book. You can fuck a cow right in front of the sheriff. And all he can say is, boo! Which you can hardly expect to bring down the barn with an act like that. With the right virus offset, perhaps we can get this whole show out of the barnyard and into space. This is the space age, and we are here to go.
They asked him at a press conference what he thought of a gay rights movement. And his response was, I have never been gay a day in my life, and I'm sure as hell not part of any movement. But Burroughs was a deconstructor of labels. You know, that was just another sort of amalgamized effort to not be marginalized. And he was one of the very few, maybe Jean Genet, maybe Pier Paolo Pasolini, who had the balls way before it was like vogue, and certainly when it was dangerous, to say, I'm queer.
But he was way beyond that, because he didn't respect any of the rules of the gay world at all, either. He was hardly a boys in the band. You know, he would have hated that. I mean, that culture would have been very foreign to him because there were so many rules. There were so many rules in the straight world, too. And he violated the rules of even junkies' worlds. He opened up to me, not gay culture, he opened up gay rebels that couldn't fit in gay culture. Very different.
And I have to say that Burroughs, to this day, and his work, have an uneasy relationship with queer culture in America, or queer writing, or whatever. Burroughs was never seen as part of that. He was still too transgressive. Even when it became sort of okay to be queer, he was beyond queer.
More on this end, right here, go on.
No.
Oh, my
God.
I have to sort of take Burroughs and Warhol as parallel figures. Two people who, in the late 50s and early 60s, stood up for what they believed in, made no pretense about it, were totally out front about it. At that time, that was absolutely outrageous. I mean, it's hard for people who didn't live in those times to know. When I moved to America in 1965, you could not mention the word homosexuality without everyone thinking you were gay. So, and it was really just verboten. And it's because of Burroughs and Warhol and what followed in their wake that the whole gay liberation movement sprung up.
How old were you when you had sex? 13? 14? 15?
16?
Boarding
school.
Boarding school.
Boarding school.
Okay, so what, you had sex when you were 16 with who?
Boy in the next bunk.
William's boyfriends were a series of obsessions. usually more or less foredoomed. Well, first of all, his cousin, Prin Hoxie, in St. Louis, who went off to a different university, Princeton, and then died a year and a half later in a drunken accident in New York. He was decapitated by a tunnel. And then he fell in love with a boy at Los Alamos Ranch School, and there was a big disgrace, and little Billy ran away home to St. Louis and couldn't go back to Los Alamos at all. Sent off for his diaries, and as he wrote, when the box arrived, the fearful diaries in them, he couldn't wait to rip it open and make sure he could destroy the offending pages. Some of these things were examples of how he had tried to write and why he had given up. He says, fact is, I had gotten a sickener, meaning like a jail sentence. I mean, his boyfriends like Jack Anderson, the one that he cut his finger off over and who helped him wreck the family car. Louis Marker, the American student at Mexico City College, who was probably a pretty good intellectual company, but was not going to commit his life to Bill Burroughs. So he very much was thinking of boyfriends as members of a class different from him. After I'd lived with William for several weeks, and then began my relationship with Richard Elovich, my first lover, I remember William commenting once, see, you and Richie have this idea about intellectual and social equals being a couple. He says, in my day, that's just unheard of. I mean, it was an inter-class thing.
In the fall of 89, I met him at his old place, his old stomping grounds in the Bowery, the Bunker. And at that time I was 18, I was a freshman in college. I was already basically Allen Ginsberg's boyfriend, but I was kind of planned out that I would still hook up with William when and if the opportunity presented itself.
But were you sexually interested in me at that time, do you think?
I don't. Not.
Because I don't remember any.
I don't remember any such thing. Mm-hmm.
How come? That's interesting, because I was kind of cute. Looking back, my hindsight.
Well, I don't know.
If it was like an ordinary relationship in one of his novels, it was usually the theme of chasing after somebody that didn't quite want to have anything to do with the author of what you're reading. Which was, I think, in Queer, something that was shown, like what his writings were for. They were love letters to make the person that he was interested in laugh, because they were almost comedy routines.
In a way, he was somebody who appeared to be incredibly sad to me as time went by. Someone who'd been hurt. For example, you read that William was crazy in love with Allen Ginsberg, and that it was almost always an unrequited passion. And I think that disappointment that he had when he did fall in love, which was so rare for him, made him a lot more withdrawn sexually and emotionally, a lot more afraid of being vulnerable and then being hurt. So he started to close down quite a lot emotionally.
Do you want to be loved?
Not really. Depends. Mm-hmm. By yeah. Who or what. Yeah. By my cat, certainly. Mm-hmm.
There was something essentially alien about William, and I think when it came to his physicality and his romantic life, he was one of the most awkward people in the world. While there was this facade of a gentleman, there was a very lonely man underneath that three-piece suit. And it was only once that I really heard him speak of someone he was genuinely interested and obsessed with, Mark Ewart, who he described as a young man having skin like alabaster.
One night I was like, I should tell this guy I love him, right? It was late at night, and I wasn't quite sure if he had already fallen asleep for the night or not. So I kind of nudged him and said, William. William. Yeah? I said, William, I love you. I love you, William. So, you love women? I said, no, no. No, I said, I love you, William. And then what did he say back? He's like, oh, that's okay, or something like that, and kind of patted me. But then the question is, well, what did he feel towards me, or what did he feel towards other human beings in general? I remember reading this interview with him, and he was talking about nuclear war. And he said that all of a sudden he just started sobbing, which first of all, it was really hard for me to picture him sobbing, period. But what he was sobbing about is he said he had all of a sudden been thinking about nuclear war, and then he was struck with this horrific thought of, well, what would happen to my cats, my six cats, if I died? And that just wrecked him. You can just see that cats were these pure spirit beings for him. And I remember some of our very first conversations, the first night I met him, were about endangered species and about lemurs that he was really into. And I think that was just a really safe place for his love to flow. And I don't think that like his animals and his cats and these lemurs. And I don't think that means that love was false, but I definitely had the sense that it was all kind of flowing in this fairly narrow channel that would probably have been too hard for him in this lifetime to show for other people. And I hope in whatever his next lifetime is nowadays, it's easier for him, and it's not so threatening.
All right, I'll get you something.
One side, he's this kind of loosey-goosey liberal of his time, where sexuality is, free-spirited and all that sort of thing. I don't think he engaged in that all that comfortably. I think he had conflict around his sexual orientation. I don't think that was always clear to him. I think he probably struggled with homophobia like lots of people his age.
I mean, there are areas of his life that he himself never understood. Quite clearly, a number of things happened to him when he was very little. He was possibly abused by his nanny's boyfriend and things like this. But I mean, and he spent a lot of time in psychoanalysis trying to find out about these things. But he has talked about it, but it's just too deeply buried. He never really was able to find out.
Do you think we should charge for sex? What? Do you think we should charge for sex?
Yeah, I do.
I think so.
Should we pay?
So
well, it depends on the circumstances.
Can I ask you, not, nothing personal, you've said you like young boys, but young boys, is it easier to have a relationship with them that's like, not just sex? Can you go out and have dinner with them? Can you talk to them? Can you?
In many cases, no.
They don't have a concentration.
But I don't require that.
Oh.
We first met him in the 70s. He was living in London. There was an Irish hustler called John who was sharing the apartment with him, who used to hang out in Piccadilly, doing something or other sexually to get money. And William always seemed to prefer young hustlers, because there was no need for an emotional attachment. There was no danger of being embroiled beyond a controllable point. So I think that was one of the reasons that he began to almost exclusively look for sexual pleasure amongst professional young hustlers. There was too much fear of pain to go into a relationship form of love.
You talk about keeping yourself open, being able to see. Is it something that you keep at bay, this idea of possession? Is it something you don't want to have happen?
Oh, yes. Well, generally speaking, yes. Well, there's a difficult question there. That is, you laying yourself open to experience, and that's the only way that you can experience, but also there's a danger of laying yourself open to something that is very injurious.
How do you know that?
And how do you don't. That's just it, you don't. It's like the, when you let your immunity down there, you can get AIDS. That has always been a problem of being receptive, but at the same time able to defend yourself against injurious attacks and influences, because they're sure to be there. It's like disease organisms.
William had a very uneasy relationship with women in the sense that there weren't too many women around, but I felt that I had a very nice relationship with him, and maybe it was because we really weren't gender identified when we were together. We traded recipes, but I would say that in that world, particularly if you're, you know, at the bunker and you're going into the bathroom and you're looking at Keith Haring's drawing of the penis, it's not the world that you would expect.
I had the biggest crush on William, really a big one. And I used to even daydream about, you know, he would fall in love with me and we would get married. I mean, I had a huge crush on William, so, and he knew it too, and it didn't bother him at all. When the two of us were alone, he'd say, "Well, my dear, it's the end of the night. Let's hear a little Bobby Shafto." And I would sing him the little song. Bobby Shafto's gone to sea, silver buckles on his knee. One fine day he'll marry me, pretty Bobby Shafto. There was another one. Oh dear, what can the matter be? Dear, dear, what can the matter be? Oh dear, what can the matter be? Johnny so long at the fair. And he encouraged me to sing before I sang publicly. I think actually William loved Brian Gysin more than anybody.
He was my friend of many years, painter, writer, musician, and raconteur extraordinaire. Boy, could he tell a story. His studies of North African music and magic, of Japanese and Arabic calligraphy, as well as his own painting and writing, were influential upon a whole generation of creative individuals who went on to launch the cultural revolution of the 60s and 70s. He was at ease with the Rolling Stones, the magicians of ancient Shizuoka, with the princesses and duchesses of Europe, and the young emigres who flocked to the Beat Hotel in Paris in the 1950s. When we lived there and began our collaboration, Brian invented the dream machine and the cut-up method, and his ideas were crucial to my own development as a writer.
The cut-up was invented by Brian Gysin in the Beat Hotel. He wanted to set up a board for his artwork, and he had some newspapers on a table, and he cut through the board using the Stanley blade, and he cut through the newspapers. And when he looked at the newspapers, he realigned the pages of type, and he could see that words made a particular kind of sense, almost like a telepathic sense. And he felt that he had discovered something truly fantastic, and showed it to William Burroughs, and was just so inspired, and was able to really do terrific cut-ups. In fact, William produced 3 cut-up novels.
You know, William had read a lot in philosophy, the nature of consciousness, in science, in mind travel, you know, magic, tantrism, genetics, the cloning worlds, looking at semantics, looking at intrinsic nature, looking at impermanence, looking at how we name and qualify, and where does that come from?
That is all.
His dedication to altered states and knowledge and tinkering with consciousness, that as well, I mean, always leads one into conflict with the powers that be, because that too is an illegal activity.
The flicker administered under large dosage and repeated later could well lead to overflow of the brain areas, sounds and even odors. That is a categorical characteristic of the consciousness expanding. Gray waters produce many of the phenomena. Anything that can be done chemically can be done in other ways.
The first things that William was investigating as a personal crusade or as a personal philosophy, all those things made him an outcast, an outsider, and an outlaw, quite literally. When you have someone who's knowingly choosing to be outside the law or to refuse to accept the template of legality that some societies imposed upon them, then you have the potential for some degree of chaos or destruction of that status quo, that nonsensus reality. So William chose a path that he knew would bring him into conflict with the powers that be, with social norms, and with the legal system. And he chose it because it would be intolerable to him to be a hypocrite and hide away his real sense of being.
I bring not peace, but a sword.
It's no mistake that the main obsession of Burroughs was control. First time we met in 1971, just before we left his apartment, he said to me, "How do you short-circuit control? That's what I want you to spend your time thinking about, meaning my life." And that's basically what we've done.
As long as you don't decide not to either be act or say, but just sort of hide and be a hypocrite, then you're doing their job. People have to do it different ways. But no, I think that William was a very, very political, radical, anarchist man.
In Oklahoma, we found a tiny little bit of pot down by his right leg. He got life in prison without parole. A minuscule amount.
Are you going to shoot that son of a bitch?
Yeah. Where? In America?
Oklahoma.
His upbringing was middle class, but he had a housekeeper who introduced him to opium. So it's not surprising that he went in the direction that he went.
Well, if you got the Yahe papers, and he's the only guy I've ever known to take Yahe, which is the absolute sine qua non of hallucinogenic drugs. And he's also the guy that Timothy Leary and Babaram Das came over to Morocco and had him try psilocybin. He's the only guy I've ever heard of or known to take the original CIA's version of LSD, LSD-6, which is like a horse pill of insanity. I mean, the stuff that I did as a hippie in the 60s, you know, was like, bubblegum, was fool's gold compared to the extensive experience that that guy had. He was a walking pharmacologist, you know, in the encyclopedia of it.
There's a junk gesture that marks the junkie like the limp wrist marks the fag. The hand swings out from the elbow, stiff-fingered, palm up.
William Burroughs, sure, he romanticized drug use, but not in the way that usually people think romantic. I think no one had written about it. Nobody had read about it. It was a hidden, terrible thing. So that someone wrote about it in any kind of joyous way, which he did, joyous and terrible and wonderful, sure, he did romanticize it. Did anybody read Naked Lunch and try heroin? Probably. So what? That doesn't mean that book shouldn't be read. I'm for anybody that writes about their obsession and shows a murderer that can write a book about how great it is to murder. Doesn't mean it's not a good book.
What the breakthrough of the late 50s was after Howe was a breakthrough to those people who lived in America and were Americans but who were never focused on. And so the whole question of narcotics, even with the fantastic thing that Burroughs conceived of it, the idea that there were junkies in America, was somewhat of a social breakthrough.
Burroughs was cool, particularly in his persona. Usually when we think of cool in context of the hip world, the beat world, we're thinking of the difference between alcohol and heroin. Hip people who liked to take dope or who were addicted to it, they thought it was the pinnacle of coolness to go score a bag, maybe of Dr. Nova. They even had like William's own brand in a way, or many brands. Score a glassine bag of this and take it to the bunker to share it with the Pope of Dope.
On the street outside, Rivington and Bowery was a big pickup place. The junkies for five blocks going east. Howard was coming to visit. He said, John, I scored for William. And they shot up together. I mean, Howard at that point had to be HIV positive. But William, having seniority, shot up first. William shot up many times. People came and visited. But he always got the first shot so that he never got AIDS. I thought that was pretty great. I mean, everyone died, you know, sadly so.
There's always a question with someone who has the glamour image, let's say Burroughs had, or Keith Richards has, or Lou Reed has, where they're seen to kind of glamorize using heroin. It seems like a very cool sort of thing, you know. But if you read everything William wrote about heroin, it was to warn people to not take it. And he was using it as a sort of image or symbol of control, that this is the ultimate control. You have to buy the product or else you're sick.
I'm doing this press conference with Bill. I said, Bill, you know, I had this migraine last night, man, and I came by these pills in my medicine cabinet, and two Percodans, and his eyes went, what? I said, well, what are they? And he said, what do you mean, what are they? I said, well, what is Percodan? And he put his face about an inch from mine and said, it's junk. And walked away. And I sat there with my metaphorical ass spanked and immediately saw the distinction between this actor who was acting Bill Lee and his addictions and a guy who'd like roamed the world in a sewer hooked on this shit. That said, that whole incident with him, man, with him leveling me with its junk, was like a laser through me about everything else in my life that I'm doing or taking on a whim, not just pills, you know, sex or careerism or cigars or whatever that I think are just like, I can get by through, I can wing this today, I can hold my breath through this now, because it's not the real deal. And then all of a sudden you wake up and it is the real deal. You know, it is life handed to you on a toilet seat, you know, rather than a silver platter.
He opened the tunnel to a way out. Because if you're doing something and you want to stop, you're not going to stop until you figure out what it is you're actually doing.
It's like ultra subject regulator. It's a unique apomorphine, a metabolic dramatic relief from anxiety. Dimethyltryptamine, alarming and disagreeable symptoms. The use of opium and our derivatives.
The legend is that he went to London and kicked it with the apomorphine cure in 1956. The reality is that he was chipping around and off and on to one extent or another his whole life. I mean, when I met him in 1974, he was not taking it except just, you know,
gobble a pill or whatever, but within 2 years, he was again. And at that time, it got such a grip on him that the breakthrough there was to enroll in the methadone maintenance program. Under his physician was named Dr. Harvey Carcass.
Give me something to shoot.
It kicks like a mule, babe.
I want something to shoot.
Great Big Mamba Jamba was a gift from Hunter Thompson. It's a 454 Kessel. It was the biggest handgun manufactured at the time. The gun that he carried the most when I was around him was a 38 Smith & Wesson Snubby. And he just carried on his belt with him at all times. Although there was a couple times when he was going to the barber shop or the doctor, and it would make people uncomfortable to look down and see this old man with a big piece on his belt. So Michael didn't want him to wear the big gun, so I think the compromise they worked out was that he'd carry Derringers rather than a big pistol on his belt. But when he was at home, he always had a gun on. He slept with the gun under his pillow.
When we slept together in bed, was there a loaded gun in a holster in the bed with us? Why, yes, there was a loaded gun in a holster in bed with us. There were guns everywhere in his house, everywhere. I remember one of the first nights we were sleeping together in his place in Kansas, and you know, I'm sticking my feet down in the covers, and my foot hits some bump, some really hard bump. I'm like, William, what is that? He's like, oh, it's a gun. And I'm like, oh, is that gun loaded? And he goes, oh yeah, it's always keep it loaded. That way you never have to worry about whether it's loaded or not.
This is a silencer. This was in William's basement. Take like a 38 and shoot it in the basement. There was a target across the basement. Upstairs, this is about what you'd hear. Oh, louder than that. That's a gun going off. But down, and you wouldn't even barely, people would be sitting there in the dining table, and they wouldn't even, and we come up from the basement and say, did you hear that? And they'd say, what? And it was shooting six rounds of 38s.
I would imagine he got a feedback high out of it in the sense that this is better than shooting heroin. I mean, you shot something else and it went bang.
He had a fascination with guns that was all his own. I've often wondered what it sprung from, whether it was, you know, being gay and being subjected to the kind of abuse that gay people sometimes find themselves. And he was a slight man, he was never a big guy. And whether that made him feel more secure, because I know he always had a gun at home, and he was always, you know, he talked about defending himself.
He had always, I think half his fantasy life was what he would do if somebody did something. Mm-hmm. Like when there was a dog attacking us on the way to Dillon's, man, he had 14 different plans on how to take care of that.
Burroughs himself, he said you always have to have three lines of defense. He had the sword cane that if you pressed a button, it became a spear, really. So he had a cane, but he knew the art of cane fighting. He'd studied it. He had a book on it. And then he had the cobra. And then he also had a sharp knife that he could flick out real fast. He studied all these arts of self-defense.
In his writing, you see, he's always pushing himself to the limits of psychic limits. And the feeling of danger, I think, that is evoked by that was something that intrigued him about snakes. Snakes represented, among other things, a form of weaponry to William Burroughs, and the injection process of a snake venom is very, very similar to the projectile firing ability of a gun. He was also very fascinated with the addictive properties of snake venom.
Ken, if you had your choice, would you rather be a poisonous snake or a non-poisonous snake? Poisonous, sir, like a green mamba or a spitting cobra. Why? I'd feel safer, sir. Safer? Yes, sir. Dead people are less frightening than live ones. It's a step in the right direction. Young man, I think you're an assassin.
I wrote him a letter, so I offered to send him a Gaboon viper. And I did this, ending my letter with something almost like a threat. If I do not hear from you a positive or negative reply, you may consider the snake in transit. So he rapidly responded. And in fact, I had two or three quick letters, please begging me not to send the Gaboon viper. But I did also get an invitation to his house. And in those days, I often carried snakes around in suitcases. So he wanted to see the snake's feed. And I think I had a rattler in there and a couple of copperheads. And I put a mouse or a small rat in there for them to eat it. The rat had jumped out of the way, evidently not going to get bitten. So William just blindly, thoughtlessly reached in with his hand, grabbed the mouse or rat to move it into a position that the snake could bite it. And when he did that, at that moment, the snake struck. And I think it just grazed his hand. I mean, it just brushed his hand. And so I was very nearly responsible for killing William Burroughs on that trip for when he reached in. Very brave guy, you know, but not, you know, I don't think so cautious as he should have been.
He to go have some cocktails Magnum with Fred and then come out and say, "See, my hand is really steady now."
Yeah.
Well, a few vodka cokes will do that for you. But the thing about William, and Tom does this as well as I do, is that he'd be, "Now, did I tell you about the," and he'd have a drink and be, "Whoop," as you think it's going to go over, and then he's got to fall down.
Wound up as an alcoholic academic. Will he get tenure?
That's the moment.
Now, William, for a while, rented this cottage. And one time, I'm told, I was out of town, and he put some bales of hay up against that stone wall over there. I heard about it. I thought, oh, my God, it's a wonder if he's still alive. Because, of course, the bullets went through the bales of hay, came right back. So Patricia tells a story that one time he was out here doing that, and he had some bottles of black ink apparently dangling from strings. So the old man standing here blasting away, and suddenly he goes back, and there's this great big splot on his forehead. And of course, the first impulse, I guess, whoever was with him thought he had shot himself, but then they noticed it wasn't red, it was black. Well, apparently a piece of the glass from the bottle had ricocheted back and hit him, and it's a miracle that he lived as long as he did with all of the things that he did.
Joan Vollmer was Edie Kerouac Parker's roommate. Everybody thought that she was this incredible, charming, intelligent woman, and she should meet William Burroughs. So they started to hang out together. They did drugs together. William was also seeing men, and Joan suffered from that. And by the time they got to Mexico City, Joan was doing a lot of Benzedrine inhalers and drinking a lot and so on.
William Burroughs had just returned to Mexico City from a long trip with Lewis Marker, his young boyfriend. At a small homecoming party thrown by his wife, Burroughs drunkenly proposed the idea of moving to South America where he could hunt wild boar. Joan joked that if Bill were their hunter, they'd starve to death. Burroughs, taking the bait, dared Joan to show the boys what kind of a shot old Bill is, a la William Tell. Putting a gin glass on her head, she turned sideways, giggled, and said, "I can't look. You know I can't stand the sight of blood." William Burroughs fired and missed the glass, landing a fatal shot through Joan's forehead.
For somebody like Burroughs, who began also with it's a toy. I mean, he's playing William Tell with a .45, for God's sakes.
I think they were probably drunk or stoned, and they were playing around like playing Russian roulette, same kind of thing. Put the apple on your head, he tried to shoot it off and missed. I mean, it's hideous. It's like a comedy sketch almost, though.
Allen Ginsberg thought that might have been some kind of a death wish on her part.
I think Allen was very emotionally invested in saving William, helping William, healing William, and understanding it himself, and not seeing it as just an act of complete carelessness and violence, or that there was some strange dark underpinning, but something clearly some energy was out of control.
The accident left their two children without a mother. Julie, Joan's daughter from a previous marriage, was taken by her grandparents. William never saw her again. Their son, Billy Burroughs Jr., went on to live a short and troubled life. Despite William's conflicting stories about the incident, he managed to leave Mexico and never went to prison. Of Joan, Burroughs later commented, "I am forced to the appalling conclusion that I would have never become a writer but for Joan's death."
There are mistakes too monstrous for remorse to tamper or to dally with. Edward Arlington Robinson. Anyone who's never made mistakes like that and paid for his mistakes, I trust him little in the commerce of the soul.
The best he could have meant that would have been remorse was hubristic. To even entertain remorse was prideful and predicated on the idea that you could fix it, that you had the power to fix it.
One of his most extraordinary pieces is that introduction to queer, because he said those things often here, like in the passing of the decades when we're sort of drunk and alone. And he'd talk about it in terms of something that had happened at the moment of synchronicity, something happening and causing you to have a reaction and you don't know what it is. And he often talked about how in Mexico City he was walking down the street and he started crying. And then, William was very tough, so he had cried for, 10 seconds, and then continue walking, and those winding cities and streets in old Mexico, and it happened 3 or 4 times. And he was walking to meet Joan at 5 o'clock in that bar, and he didn't know why he was crying. And then only afterwards, she's dead, he remembers this, and it's the idea is that your mind, it's a synchronicity, or that your mind foresees or sees this thing that's happening in the immediate future, and you're reacting to it, and you're weeping from the horror of it.
I've constrained myself to the realization that...
Toward the end of his life, we all gathered and we all performed for him, and I decided to read from the Introduction to Queer. And I was reading it, very concentrative, and I tend to improvise when I read. So in reading something so intimate of his, I was also aware that he would be fully concentrating on how I would read it and what I might discover within it. And all of a sudden, I just went off. It's like my tongue was tied. And I just started babbling a bit.
I miscalculated. Just a few minutes or just a microsecond.
When I finished, everybody was, it was just a split second of like total silence because it was sort of a heavy moment. And then I finished, and afterwards I went up to William and I didn't know whether to apologize or I didn't know what to say. And he just took my hand and his eyes looked almost teary and he just said, "Thank you." So I would, it's like hypnotizing someone. I just feel that if William had any question in his mind whether it was an accident, that whatever I channeled, whether it be from the air or be from William himself, helped to set that at rest.
The negativity of that karma propelled him to be a writer. He had a, you know, as you know, fight his way out of a black paper bag was becoming a writer of the negative karma that he, because he loved Joan. I mean, he's a gay man, but he had a wife and he loved her. And they had many, this a great, intimate, great life together, you know? And it was a great tragedy for him.
I don't think that you have an accident like that that doesn't mark you for life. Mark what it means to hold a gun. Mark what it means to play around with it when you've done that. Now, I'm sure that that accident haunted him, for sure. Yeah.
After killing his wife, William Burroughs moved to Tangier, Morocco, where he struggled with his heroin addiction. There, in the form of notes, journal entries, and letters to Allen Ginsberg and Jack Kerouac, he excavated the literature that would become the novel Naked Lunch.
You know, Burroughs is a fairly foreboding character in his novels. It's like, I mean, I find Burroughs to be hilariously funny. You know, like, some people are like, oh, God, Naked Lunch, it's obscene. You know, all these guys getting hung, all this jism, you know, all this disgusting, you know. What's missing from that reading of Burroughs is it's totally funny. It's like this burlesque, but the material he's using is the raw images of the unconscious.
William Burroughs was alien to many people, and definitely to mainstream Western culture he was alien. And it's only an alien that would have the circumspection to write about Western culture like he did in Naked Lunch.
Naked Lunch stood out because it was so different. It was a novel that knocked people out or repulsed them. It also inaugurated the whole era of hip because it was so subversive that it had its own cachet.
In 1962, the novel was tried in Boston, Massachusetts for obscenity. The courts charged that it contained child murder and pedophilia. Burroughs' supporting witnesses included Allen Ginsberg and Norman Mailer. It would be the last major literary censorship hearing in the United States. Eventually, in 1966, the Massachusetts Supreme Court overturned the ban, ruling that the book had indeed redeeming social value, and it was henceforth widely published in the United States.
It won a lot of censorship stuff because there were no laws against that yet. They didn't know gay people that did heroin that bragged about it and talked about it and made it seem appealing. That was not on the law book. It was thinking up something that wasn't even illegal yet. And that book was so passionate. And in the beginning, you can't have a better press agent than a censor, especially in the 50s and 60s.
This is William speaking and under attack for Naked Lunch being pornographic. So he says, certain passages in the book that have been called pornographic were written as a tract against capital punishment in the manner of Jonathan Swift's Modest Proposal. These sections are intended to reveal capital punishment as the obscene, barbaric, and disgusting anachronism that it is. As always, the lunch is naked. If civilized societies want to return to the druid hanging rites in the sacred grove, or to drink blood with the Aztecs, or feed the gods with blood of human sacrifice, let them see what they actually eat and drink. Let them see what is on the end of that long newspaper spoon.
Man is carried in naked by two Negro bearers who dropped him on the platform with bestial sneering brutality. The man wriggles. His flesh turns to viscid, transparent jelly that drifts away in green mist.
I think Burroughs's writings, particularly Naked Lunch, were quite revolutionary. I mean, they talked about things that nobody talked about, especially in America, which was very I'd say, rather more sexually repressed than, you know, because of the Puritan traditions of America and so on. He really, it wasn't just homosexuality, I mean, it was just his alien sexuality.
In the 60s, it became quite political with the Yippies. I meant that they had a very definite program, and most of those objectives were realized. Mm-hmm. End of the Vietnam War, legalization of pot, end of censorship, recognition of minority rights. Mm-hmm. Most of those objectives have been at least to some extent.
When Bill witnessed an event such as that, he wrote about it. And what you get in the writing is what he saw. Yeah, I mean, he said all the obvious things, you know, it was a fascist state, it was frightening. In Grant Park, when the police were approaching, he wondered if he'd be able to withstand it or if he would break and run. He was worried about that, and also he was worried about his ability to move fast enough to get away, because after all, most people were kids, and he was like in his late 50s at that point.
My father's getting a book out. I'm going to go be with him on Saturday night for a family party on Sunday.
I think I'm changing things.
Hare Krishna. Yeah, Allen Ginsberg was more of a hippie. Hippies always got on my nerves more. I mean, we were punks without knowing we were punks. We were looked like hippies, but we had punk values. No, William was much more up our alley, my friends, because he was angry and caused trouble and was not politically correct, where Allen, in a weird way, was politically correct within the hippie movement. Burroughs was not even politically correct in the hippie movement.
There's a real connection between the Beats and the punks. The punks really are neo-beats. Much of the punk philosophy or lifestyle or attitude, you know, punk was a very good word to use.
Right in that period of time that I met him in 75, his works were influencing punk rock. And I guess early queer culture was kind of born in punk rock, I always thought.
Don't forget, he had that column, Time of the Assassins, in Crawdaddy magazine back in those days. Crawdaddy was a fairly widely read rock magazine, and so putting himself into that context, he was opening up the door to these sort of younger kids who probably only read one of his books, like probably Junkie, if anything, but really kind of adored him as the godfather of punk, which is what he became, you know. And also, you have to remember that Bill lived on the Bowery, five blocks down from CBGB's, in an area where many of the punk rock stars lived. So he really was kind of in that world. I remember Patti Smith at St. Mark's Poetry Project in 74, after a reading, ended it by telling everyone that William Burroughs was back in town. And he said, isn't that great? Welcome to New York, William Burroughs, you know?
Yeah, they're just telling me. William, I was just in Amsterdam, and I haven't been in Amsterdam since we were there.
He would read in Max's, and Patti Smith would read or else sing. And it was like the early kind of, it was the early punk movement, and he was connected to that.
He came to CBGB's all the time when we were developing our work, and through the 70s, he could be seen sitting there like the royalty that he was.
There are many passages in William's books, particularly in Naked Lunch and the Wild Boys, in which he prophesies punk rock.
William had a vision of the future that was parallel to punk rock. This idea of a pack of boys or a pack of androgynous souls scooting into the future, you know, with sores and, scarlet fever visions, and just the whole movement of Johnny, you know, in The Wild Boys. And my first album, Horses, is littered with Burroughs-type references.
Punk rock was influenced by Burroughs because I looked upon punk rock as this huge international anti-authoritarian cultural rediscovery and recreation revolution. I mean, you were trying to upend all the categories and hierarchies. You were totally anti-authoritarian, And you were after these voices that had been neglected because they weren't giving you the values of the middle-class bourgeois society. In the sense that punk was all about trying to tell the truth and be anti-authoritarian and be black humor, I think Burroughs was totally punk rock and a role model.
It's funny because, yeah, the punk rock thing I think was really exciting for him, more so than, say, like counterculture 60s kind of music. I remember in 77 seeing Burroughs. He read that piece, Bugger the Queen. It was so hip that he did that. You know, and the audience was just like completely amazed that he did that. He said, English rock group the Sex Pistols wrote a song called God Save the Queen. I think he commended it, and he says, like, I'd like to sort of further the sentiment with a piece I wrote called Bugger the Queen. And he would read these verses, and then he would, like, you know, exclaim each one with, like, Bugger the Queen! And then the whole audience was starting to join in. Every time he said it, they were, Bugger the Queen!
I went to his house a couple times and hung out, you know, shot Super 8 film and photos and whatnot, and just kind of hung out with William a little bit.
So, you know, he showed us around his backyard. We saw the different things he had going on out there. And he built this box called the Orgone Box. It was like an outhouse almost, or something like that was what it looked like. It was, you know, a bunch of plywood sheets put together with a little hole cut in the door. And you would sit in there, and I think Reich's theory was that sitting in there would allow you to gather certain accumulations of orgone energy, as he called it. They're kind of hard to explain, but I gather they have something to do with him feeling like any lacks in one's life had something to do with not being able to achieve a true and pure orgasm.
I think he thought rock and roll's bullshit. That's a, it mostly is, you know. But then, so are most novels, you know. But yeah, I don't think he had felt any great affinity for all that.
A lot of the pioneers of punk had read Burroughs extensively, like Iggy Pop, Lou Reed, and Will Shatter from Negative Trend. Some of the ideas kind of trickled into people's work, and then other people absorbed that work not knowing how much of it had come from Burroughs. Lust for Life by Iggy Pop has Johnny Yen and Hypnotizing Chickens, and I just thought it was really cool.
I wrote a song called Gimme Some Skin, which is one of my most depraved sounding numbers, apparently, people say. I love it. And I talk about him in it. I was 23 when I wrote it. And then there's one of his characters in a reference to him. And the lyric is, Typhoid Mary, she got soul, sucks all night on an old asshole. Whip it on out, whip it on in, give it to me, honey, you gotta give me some skin. And then the second verse is, Billy Billy Lee, ain't no fool, all the junkies think he's cool. It's a good vocal, you should hear it sometime. It's particular, I can't even get the words out of it.
Certainly someone like Dylan took a lot of inspiration as a wordsmith from stuff that Alan and William were doing and the way they were approaching language and what they were writing. You know, very sort of modern kind of approach to just language and using it to uncover different truths. And I think that's why people in the music community have responded to William's work, is because there were a lot of ideas that he could take off from.
One of the early Dead Kennedy songs, the B-side of our first single, was The Man with the Dogs. The song itself, the lyrics were just not coming together. I couldn't figure out how I wanted to tell the story or what belonged where, and it was just kind of a big mess. And so I finally threw up my hands and figured, what have I got to lose? I'm going to try the Burroughs method. I'm going to cut up every single line of this song and move it around until I get something I like. And sure enough, it worked.
Thank you.
some of the examples of this, sometimes when I realize I'm going to do this in advance, the rough drafts sometimes have to be kept in plastic bags and come out more like this. This is Vulcanus 2000 from a later Lard project.
Fight tuberculosis, folks. Christmas Eve, an old junkie selling Christmas seals on North Park Street. The priest, they called him. Fight tuberculosis, folks.
The medium of the counterculture was collaboration, beginning with the obvious example of rock group.
Having a good old time, the bunker there, and in the midst of the conversation, we got to Marlena Dietrich.
You bet.
Well, they had to cancel all her Australian tour because she's so drunk.
Would not heal, and she refused to listen or even discuss the possibility of surgery.
And he started singing Falling in Love Again in German. And to me, that signaled the beginning of the record. Oh, well, here's another William.
Any artistic description or any artistic transliteration has got to be unprecise. I could probably do, if I was a painter, I could illustrate some of my dreams, they'd be much closer, but words are pretty awkward to, often I'm describing very, not only very complicated, but very unfamiliar scenes. It's never going to be any more than an approximation, unfortunately.
It's not so easy just to be, if you're a really great writer like William, to go over and work with visuals, and he succeeded. But it somehow, it flowered at the end of his life, and he was able to do all these great visual works. William always claimed it was Brian's death in 86 that liberated him to become an artist.
We had been shooting out here for several years, and one day William and the people that would drive him out there showed up, and they had some cans of spray paint. So they took the cans of spray paint and they suspended them in front of the plywood, and William started blasting the spray paint over the plywood. And that was the start, at least to my knowledge, of the shotgun art.
My own like feelings about guns, over the top fake macho stuff. It didn't have, for me, richness as a work of art that his writing did.
Fake macho is funny to me. Part of art is all irony. It's making fun of everything. Contemporary art is about ruining things. So if he's ruining what masculinity and guns are, good.
You mentioned your art. Is it? Are you still the shotgun art, or is it?
Oh, all kinds.
All kinds?
Yes. Brushwork, shotgun, paint knife.
Who was it? What's the exact process? Do you set up the cans?
There's no exact process. If you wanted to have the shotgun, I'd take a piece of plywood, put a can of spray paint in front of it, and shoot it with a shotgun. The sprays across your surface, so there's no possibility of predicting what pattern you would get.
I went to the LA County Museum where he had an art show. And in the courtyard of the museum, there were all these glitterati, and Absolute had a booth, and they were serving Burroughs, because, as you know, his drink is vodka and coke. And so after we had the little soiree, they took us up for the tour of the show. So we started going down the line of all of the paintings. We got to one, which was this piece of plywood that had this angle on it. Well, I remember the guy's roof that the plywood came on, and I had to chuckle, because here it was, a scrap of plywood that had been sitting over there, and now it's got a price tag of like $7,000 on it, and it's sitting in the LA County Museum of Art. So.
John Wheeler of Recognition Physics says, nothing exists until it is observed. The artist observes something visible to others and puts on paper or canvas something that did not exist until he observed it.
Obviously, he had some shortcomings as a father, you know, even though his son's books, I think, were really, really good. He was very, very talented. But you read that biography, it was a terrible, terrible, wounded life. So was William a good father? No.
Billy Burroughs Jr. had little contact with his father, whom he tried to emulate. His father continued to neglect him, so Allen Ginsberg often came to Billy's rescue. Billy wrote two books about his struggle with alcohol and drugs. He was one of the first people in the United States to get a liver transplant. But by 1981, at the age of 33, Billy was dead of acute alcoholism.
He was here and James was here, and I was upstairs when Billy died. 10:30 in the morning, James comes upstairs and knocks on my door and says, John, I have to talk to you. Something very serious happened. Billy has died. And so we go downstairs, and I come in here, and I hugged William. And it's the only time in my life I ever saw William crying. I mean, I hugged him, and as I'm hugging him, there are these things, these great tears coming, not for very long. I mean, like, William is William. But he cried for a few minutes, and then we talked a little bit, and then he went into the bedroom and closed his door, and it was deep grief.
He was devastated. And he felt incredibly guilty about that, that he knew he hadn't been present enough in William Jr.'s life, had ignored him for years on end, and was finally becoming his friend, and it was too late. And William Jr. was trying to emulate his father for approval in the most destructive possible ways, in the most simplistic ways. If I become a junkie and write a book about a drug, then I'll be like Dad, and Dad will love me, you know? And it was a tragic situation. To see the youngest William destroying himself very publicly in front of William Sr. to try and be accepted as an equal, as part of the Beatnik family rather than the Blood family. And William just didn't know how to deal with that, how to express himself.
After Billy's death, Burroughs adopted his companion and secretary, James Grauerholtz. Together, the two left New York and moved to Lawrence, Kansas, where William spent the remainder of his life.
Which way do you want to go back?
I came to Lawrence with the intention of luring Burroughs to Lawrence, because he was reaching an age where it was kind of time to retire.
Oh, it's William. Expensive
layout. Look
at that
thing. Pink.
It was an alternative to the heroin scene of the Bowery. And I think James undoubtedly saved William, if not from drugs, from some other misadventure. William and Bacchus might fantasize about being these impenetrable gray men with canes fighting off young would-be attackers, but he was vulnerable. And, you know, an old man with a cane is just as weak as an old man without a cane.
I bought a plot yesterday, man.
Is your personal belief on death?
Personal belief on death.
Well, is that how you know that you aren't dead already? No, quite seriously, the bardo, the period between death and rebirth, which is supposed to be populated by some mythological monsters, but I think it's much more likely if the monsters were too mythological, you'd wise up that this wasn't a real myth. It was very much like your real life. You might very well be dead and not know it at all.
I was just going to say, those monsters are projections of your own mind.
Exactly, yes.
External. Mm-hmm.
But as I frequently said, I do believe in the possibility of survival after death. I think it's the only goal worth striving for.
He certainly became much more explicitly lovable, or, you know, in his final year. Gentle and sweet-tempered. Not that he was so cantankerous and difficult before, but there was a transformation.
I talked to William when Alan died, and it was incredibly hard, and he, you know, died just months later. It was as if there was some, well, with both of them, these sparks went out of the world.
When we saw James Grauerholtz just after William had passed, we met in Ginsberg's apartment in the East Village, and he showed me a picture of William just after he died that someone had taken. And it really upset me, surprised me. I started crying. And we said to James, what sort of frame of mind was he in when he died? And James said, well, look what he wrote, the last thing he wrote in his journal. And we said, oh, thank God. He managed to get there before he passed away. He finally managed to say that. But it took him a lifetime before he could say out loud that love was part of an equation of existence.
I do believe in kind of saints that you can look up to when you're young and you're starting out and you don't fit in anywhere and you want to do something in the arts and you know really early you want to do it and you know that you're going to cause trouble with what you want to do and you don't care really. You don't want to fit in. People don't like you in school, but you don't care. You don't want to be those people and you don't want to hang out with them in the first place. So William, for those people, will always be almost a religious figure, and I think that's wonderful, and I think he would like that.
Iris is just another skin, simply slips away. You can rise above it. It was shed easily. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One common wire, one silver thread. All that you desire grows on ahead. Like a ship in a bottle, held up to the sun, sails ain't going nowhere. You can count everyone until it crashes onto the earth, simply slips away. You can hide in the open, I just disappear. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One coming wire, one silver thread. All that you desire grows on ahead. Ours is just a craving and a twist of the wrist. We'll undo the stopper with abrupt tenderness. Die, little sparrow, and awake, singing. It all will come out fine. I've learned it line by line. One